done
for me.
To God be the glory.
Amen.
I count it not only a privilege, but a pleasure and a blessing to stand before you this morning as I honor Pastor Williams for just allowing me to speak on any Sunday, more or less, first Sunday. And I don't take it lightly, this assignment, and I thank God for it. I ask that you pray with me, pray for me, that God will speak through me. Before I go any further, I was a part of a great celebration last night. And I just want to give a shout out to Sister Faye Williams on her 80th birthday celebration. Those Williams sisters and brothers, they know how to party. They know how to throw a party, y'all. I also want to give a shout out to Deacon Nelson, for today is his birthday, and I want to personally say happy birthday. Glad you're in the house to celebrate with us. Now, if you will, let us go in prayer for just a moment. Oh, Father, oh, God, my all in all, my everything. Lord, I ask you to hide me behind the cross. Speak through me, speak to me, and most of all, speak to your people. Lord, I can't do anything without you. And I need you for this preaching moment. And so if you will just let Cheryl sit down and you stand up in me, everything will be all right. I ask that your word go forth with power, with anointing, but most of all with salvation in its message. That you get all the glory, all the praise, all the honor, for it all belongs to you. I bless your holy name, and in Jesus' name we pray. Let the church say amen. Me for just a minute to get this where I can deal with it. It's all right. Let us go to the word, and it's found this Sunday in Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12, chapter 1, verses 1 and the first part of verse 2. Verses 1 and the first part of verse 2. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. I didn't hear everybody say amen, so we're going to give you just a few more seconds to get to Hebrews 12 chapter, verses 1 and the first part of verse 2. And it reads as thus, according to the NIV. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off, somebody say throw off, everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out, somebody say marked out, for us. Fixing our eyes on somebody. Fixing our eyes on Jesus. And I like the way the King James says it. I'm going to read it this way because it's there in the NIV. It says, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. King James says it a little bit more familiar method. It says, the author
and the finisher.
Oh, yeah, you know, the author and the finisher of our faith. For a subject the Lord gave me this morning, hidden figures.
All right.
figures. In 1962, as NASA and astronaut John Glenn prepared for the mission to orbit the Earth and land safely back on the Earth, Glenn understood that history was about to be made, and that history would change the world forever. The complexity of the orbital flight had required the construction of a worldwide communications network. It was linking tracking stations around the world to IBM computers in Washington, D.C., in Cape Canaveral, and in Bermuda. The computers had been programmed with equations that would control the trajectory of the capsule during the Friendship 7 mission, from blast off to splashdown. But the astronauts were a little bit wary of putting their lives in the care of electronic calculating machines. They were prone to hiccups and blackouts. It was new technology and they just didn't trust it. As part of the pre-flight checklist, Glenn asked the engineers to get the girl and have her run the same numbers through the same equations that had been programmed into the computer, but do it by hand from her desktop calculator. If she says they're good, Glenn said, then I'm ready to go. It marked a turning point in the competition between the United States and the Soviet Union. You see, Glenn's flight circled the Earth. It landed just as it was projected, and it was a successful flight, and thus made history, and it changed the entire NASA flight program. The girl, known as Katherine Johnson, was a young black mathematician, a graduate of West Virginia State College, who not only was not allowed to drink from the same coffee pot, but she was barred from using the white women's restroom. You see, she was a hidden figure among the white male engineers of NASA. But if it had not been for Katherine Johnson, or if she had not calculated the figures correctly, John Glenn would never have orbited the Earth successfully. And if John Glenn had not orbited the Earth successfully in his mission, the United States would not have successfully put a man on the moon. And if the United States had not been the first to reach the moon, Neil Armstrong would never have made landed on the moon, nor made his historic quote, "One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind." And if Neil Armstrong and I made it to the moon first, the Soviet Union would have won the space race, and history as we know it would have been totally changed. Until recent years, Katherine Johnson, along with many other young black women employed in our space program at NASA, known as human computers, were just hidden figures. But they were hidden figures that changed the world. And I submit to you this morning, we all have some hidden figures. We got some folk that nobody acknowledges. No one knows that they are in your life. But if it hadn't been for their support, their encouragement, their friendship, their mentorship, their help along the way, you would not be where you are today. There are some no-name folk that showed up to pray for you, that stood by you when no one else would, that waited on you, gave their last dime to you. They lent you money to go to college. They fed you. They clothed you. They worked hard so you could be something in life. They were hidden figures that made all the difference in your life. And you need to take a moment this morning to thank God for some hidden figures. You see, it's the hidden figures in our lives that have many times caused us to stay on the straight and narrow. I don't know about you this morning, but if it had not been for some hidden figures in my own life, if it had not been for those hidden figures that pulled me aside when I was headed in the wrong direction, heading down a wayward path, I could have been in jail. My life would have taken a different turn. And my soul may have still been lost. My life resume and bio would have read a different way. But it was some hidden figures that challenged me to run the race that set before me in life. Yeah, I'm thinking about some of them right now, and I'm making my and I'm getting a little happy over it. Because hidden figures can make all the difference in your life. Just like in our text this morning, we realize that Paul calls it to our attention that life is a race. Oh, yes, it is. And how you run the race determines your outcome, whether you'll be a winner in eternity or a loser in a burning hell. And that's a fact worth considering. The truth of the matter is that some of us would not be sitting here today had it not been for some hidden figures. So don't discard or devalue hidden figures. The no-name folk in your life that have taken the time to mentor you, to support you, and to encourage you along the way. Paul in our text calls our attention to three main points about hidden figures. And his first point is the hidden witnesses to watch. You find it in verse 1. It says, therefore, seeing we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. And I don't know, but anytime you see the word therefore, you ought to ask the question, what is it there for? And in this case, it is there to let us know that there is a great number, a cloud, if you will, of witnesses all around you, compassing about you, surrounding you. And these witnesses are not necessarily watching us as much as we have been watching them. What do you mean, Sister Cole? You see, these witnesses that Paul is referencing, all those folk in chapter 11 that are spoken of, which we sometimes call the Faith Hall of Fame, these biblical saints that have gone before us and demonstrated how to stand on your faith. But not only those found in chapter 11, but also those old saints that you witnessed coming up, those preachers and deacons and Sunday school teachers and mothers of the church that labored in the word with us. And they walk before us, not in perfection, but in maturity and in wisdom. And they modeled it for us, although imperfectly, but consistently, how to worship God in spirit and in truth. And they not only sang Zion songs at the church house, Linda, but you could hear those old saints in the kitchen singing, I love the Lord. He heard my cry. You would hear them crying out while cleaning sitting in the house or the garage, you'd hear them saying, Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. If you withdraw yourself from me, whether shall I go? They were hidden figures that went before us in the Lord. And Paul says there's a great cloud of them. And we would do well this morning to follow their example that was set before us. If you take a moment, you can see them now. You just need to wind your memory. You need to remember their walk before you. You need to take some clues of the legacy of service. Oh yeah, we have this cloud of witnesses that have gone before us, beckoning us to keep on running, keep on believing, keep on trusting, keep on moving, for there is a finish line up the road. And keep those hidden figures cheering you on. And although you may have had good hidden figures in your life, Paul says you still have a race to run. Your hidden figures have already run their race. They finished their course. And the question this morning is, will you finish your race? And then that begs another question. What's hindering you from running? And which brings us to the second point that Paul makes in the text. He says, I'm glad you ask, because the answer is found in the latter part of the first verse. It reads, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. Paul describes the hindrances in a twofold manner. It's a 1-2 punch, if you will. Paul identifies one hindrance that you are already familiar with, and that hindrance is sin. For sin is the greatest hindrance to a saint. It blocks our relationship with the life source, God Himself. It steals your power to run. You're running, but you're running in place. It steals your desire to run. It takes away your passion for running and your purpose for running. It surrounds you like a compass, making a complete circle around you. So is this sin that Paul speaks about. It's sin that so easily besets us. The sin that stands well. It's ever surrounding you and soliciting your participation. It's that sin that you frequently commit. The habitual sin ever circling you and calling your name. It's the easily besetting sin that envelops your mind, your body, your soul, your spirit. The one that meets you at every turn, the one that's always in your presence, calling you out to come and participate. It often hems you up like a high wall sealed around you, and you have to either leap over it or you have to break through it. Anybody know that kind of sin I'm talking about this morning? It's a stronghold sin that you have wrestled with for years, and don't tell anybody right now, but when it has its way in your life, you'll need a breakthrough. Anybody needing a breakthrough from that sin this morning? Well, it's like the word says, the wages of sin is death. So when the easily besetting sin gets through with you, gets through sifting you, it will hinder your walk, it'll hinder your faith, it will hinder your ministry, it'll hinder your prayers and your praise. It will take your anointing, and if left alone and not dealt with, it desires to ultimately kill you. Tell somebody, but I came for a breakthrough. Oh, I want to hear you loud if you really mean it. I came for a breakthrough. I came for deliverance from that sin, the one that's been plaguing me, that sin, the one that's been slowing me down, that sin, the one that just keeps on calling my name, that sin. I came this morning for a breakthrough. I don't know about you, but I got one of that sin, and I need a breakthrough this morning.
are you looking at me? But if you really think about it, you got one too. You just don't want to admit it. But I tell God this morning, I admit I got one. And I'm here, I'm preaching to myself this morning. I need a breakthrough. I need it right now. And I know the God I serve is able. He's the breakthrough God. He's the God that will deliver you. He won't leave you. He won't forsake you. He'll give you the breakthrough. Oh, yes, he will. Anybody need deliverance? Anybody need a breakthrough? For that sin has had you going around long enough. I hope you came this morning for a breakthrough. And if so, holler real loud. I plead the blood of Jesus over that sin. And it no longer has me bound. I'm laying aside that sin in the name of Jesus. And now we ought to give the Lord some real praise. Praise him for the breakthrough. See, church folk just kind of, they blow me because you just got a breakthrough. You didn't make it feel it. You may not even know it, but you just got a breakthrough because the blood still works. Oh, yes, it does. The blood still works. You did plead the blood. Was your shout cue. That was your stand up, holler up. I'm already preaching. I don't know what you're waiting on. I don't understand. Gotta give him some glory for myself. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, Paul, in his wisdom, lets us know that sin's not only the hidden fig, it's not only a hidden hindrance. Paul identifies another bad actor, another hindrance in the life of the saint. And you know, Paul is getting on my nerves this morning. I'm gonna be honest. Paul is getting on my nerves because I just got a breakthrough from the sin that so easily beset me. And now he tells me I got another hindrance. So he's really racking my nerves because I'm saying, Paul, I done got rid of my sin. I got my breakthrough. Why are you trying to steal my joy right about now, Paul? I'm not understanding. But Paul says that's not the only hindrance you've got. And so Paul identifies another bad actor. He tells us that in the second part of verse 1. He tells us that there's another hindrance that's keeping us from running our race, slowing us down, blocking our progress, blocking our view. He lets us know that we are all subject to carrying weight. Now, Paul is in my business because I carry some weight. See, y'all looking at the physical, but Paul ain't talking about my physical. Paul says, I'm carrying weight. And guess what? You carrying weight. You looking at my weight while I'm looking at your weight. Because you carrying weight too. Now, most of us are real good at identifying sin. We know sin when we see it. We know sin when we hear it. We know sin when we see it in action. And we can really recognize it when it's on somebody else. We can point it out real quick in somebody else's life. And you'll see us saying, that's sin. That's sin over there. Even sinners can identify sin. But weights, see, weights are different. They're a different subject. See, weights are more subtle. You know how you put on pound and you don't really realize you didn't put it on. And so you'll try to put in, get all of that in them pants you wore 2 years ago.
and you can't quite zip them up, you know, and you wonder, where did all of this come from? Because weights are a little more subtle. You know when you put on the jacket and it used to be real loose, but now it's kind of tight, and you start wondering what happened, and you start lying to yourself and saying the thing done shrunk. Because I know it's not me, it's the suit. Because weights are more subtle. They are less detectable. Weights are hidden. They masquerade in our lives as friends. They masquerade as loved ones. They masquerade as mentors. They masquerade as harmless pastimes. They masquerade as harmless activities. Weights hide out in us as pride and jealousy and greed and hatred and unforgiveness and gossip. And we allow them to hang on because they're not sin. You see, you will ask God to forgive your sins, but you'll hang on to the weights. And it's the weights that weigh your spiritual walk down. It's the weights that held you back so much that you can't run anywhere. You stopped running long ago because there you carrying that extra weight. They add unnecessary burdens. They add unnecessary baggage. They add unnecessary stress. They add unnecessary drama to your life, and they slow your ability to run your race. No matter how fast you used to be, how much Bible you know, how many church services you go, how often you pray, weights will slow your spiritual road. They'll cause you to stumble along the race. Oh, I hear you asking the question, Sister Cole, you telling me my problem. So how do I detect the weights? Well, I'm glad you asked, because they are not easily detected. If you find yourself always tired and you don't know why, if your prayers seem to be hindered, even though you're praying all the time, if you stay worried and can't seem to activate your faith, if you're going through countless failure after failure after failure, then you need to understand that these are signs of weights. And it's the weights that have you bogged down with no energy, no power, no love. You're mad at everybody. You're telling everybody off. And to get rid of the weights, you have to go through a spiritual diet. Yeah, I said it. And nobody likes a diet. But you got to go through a spiritual diet to get rid of the weights. And I didn't tell Natasha to talk about weights in this thing this morning, but I had to laugh at the agreement of God. Okay? So you got to go through a spiritual diet. So that means I got to stay away from some stuff. I have to stay away from no good friends. I got to stay away from drama-filled family members. I have to fast from filthy movies and TV shows and dirty books. See, all that is weight. And I got to eat more of the word. I got to sup more with the Lord in prayer and praise. I got to stay off the hating, the backbiting, the lying, the gossiping. I got to substitute in my diet some love, some patience, some long-suffering, and some kindness. I got to try doing a good deed and helping somebody in need. You have to heed Paul's warning and lay aside every weight that hinders you. So if I was you, I'd go ahead and get on my feet, lift my weights in the air, and tell the Lord I'm tossing my weights. aside because I'm getting ready to really run. I'm getting ready to run for the Lord. No one waits for me. I'm laying aside every weight that so easily beset me. Have you ever seen a runner show up for the race? Well, he or she may start out at the starting line looking real nice. They'll be in their designer warm-up suit. They'll be in their nice sunshades, and they'll be wearing the matching cap to match the warm-up suit. But soon as the officials start saying, you better get ready, you'll see them start to take all of that off. You'll see them stripped down to nothing but a shirt, nothing but some tennis shoes, nothing but some short shorts. Because every good runner knows that to run your best race, you have to run light. You can't run heavy. You got to strip down, folks. You need to lighten up. You need to strip down some friends, strip down some places, strip down some pastimes, strip down some relationships, strip down some family folks, strip down. Tell somebody you need to strip down. You need to go ahead and start waving now and say, bye, Felicia, because you need to strip down some stuff. You got to strip down even some organizations. Oh, yeah, Virginia, I love Delta. I pledged it a long time ago, and I'm glad that I did. But when Delta gets in the way of Sunday school, when it gets in the way of 11 o'clock service, when it gets in the way of Bible study, I got to tell Delta, you are second to none, but you are second. Jesus is first in my life. He's first. So you need to strip away some stuff, because anything that gets in the way of your purpose, your praise, and your presence before the Lord, you need to strip it away. You need to lay it aside and get ready to run. Tell somebody, get ready to run. You in the race of your life, baby. And Satan and some weights, those hidden hindrances in your way, are trying to block your progress. Tell somebody, it's time to strip. Oh, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Because there's a victory finish in your future. Tell somebody, there's a victory finish in my future. Because I can begin at 65. I'm beginning to see the finish line. And so sometimes the closer we get to the finish line, the more anxious we become. Because we start to get a view of the finish line. I'm about to retire. And so that's about to be finished. But as another finish line that I'm starting to get the view of. And the closer you get to the finish line, you gotta be careful. Because as you get closer, you'll start doing some things that God didn't ordain for you to do. Hang with me for a minute. Because you'll become less patient for the race. See, you almost there, so you'll start doing some things. But you better hear Paul's quick one-liner to warn us. Because if you don't, you'll start changing lanes to go around folk. You'll start usurping authority that God never ordained for you.